we have you here, I just want to take an opportunity. You mentioned about U.S. Pointer, and let's start there a little bit. It's very exciting for the Alzheimer's Association to be leading this type of a trial, but also for Northern California to be really actively participating in U.S. Pointer. What are you most excited about when you think about a lifestyles interventions trial in regards to our work at the association?
Right. I think I brought up a little bit about how I think that the association is very uniquely positioned to run a clinical trial like this. And we're so embedded in the communities that we have. And if a trial like this reports out with significantly positive results, we have the capacity to move that into the interventions that we provide to our communities today, and we will potentially have the capacity to even be having those conversations with physicians and the communities. But I think what the trial really supports is the most rigorous way that this has ever been tested in the U.S. and really in the world to help represent sort of diverse populations. Because we've seen the test, we've seen lifestyle intervention studies happen in smaller countries like Finland and even in China and Australia, but we just have not seen a clinical trial like this run in a country that has diverse population as the U.S.
Yeah, and I feel like we're learning more and more every day about risk factors for all races and ethnicities. And right. You know, why is that so important that we understand the diversity population in regards to this type of a trial?
Right. So we know that Alzheimer's disease and other dementias are very, very complex. And I think we're learning more and more every day about how those different modifiable risk factors, as well as some of the risk factors that we cannot change, like genetics, combine to create the clinical symptoms of the disease. And so I think when we talk about genetics in particular, there's studies coming out every day about how genetics may play more of a role for some ethnic, racial and ethnic populations, but not for others. And we were just discussing a study just the other day where they found that the APOE4 gene may not play as much of a role for the African American population in risk for developing Alzheimer's disease, but it does for Caucasians, which is surprising because we also have a higher population of African Americans in our country living with Alzheimer's disease. So we're still trying to understand what those differences mean and how some of these modifiable risk factors will play a role in the future in the development.
Yeah, I think that it's funny for all of these years we've been sort of looking at the same couple of baskets, and you know what they say about baskets, right? You're not supposed to put your eggs in all one basket, and I think we're starting to see that kind of trend emerge where we're learning more and more every day, which is really exciting. You know, one of the things I was thinking of in regard to the results that we could get from U.S. Pointer. You mentioned on a slide about the A4 trial, which I love talking about the A4 trial because I think when we talk about the need for clinical trial participations, these are some of the bravest clinical trial participants that have decided to enter into the A4 trial. Can you talk just for a high-level overview of what A4 is?
Sure. The A4 trial is looking at individuals that actually have amyloid in their brains but do not yet have any cognitive symptoms. They're not experiencing cognitive symptoms at all. So, but they are at risk for developing those cognitive symptoms because they've had an amyloid PET scan that shows that there's a buildup of amyloid in their brain. What this study is looking at is actually testing anti-amyloid therapies in those individuals before they even show signs of clinical symptoms. So these people are not part of the DIAN-TU population. They're not individuals living with dominantly inherited version of Alzheimer's disease. They have the sporadic version. So these individuals are basically going to be testing a drug and hoping that it will prevent the onset of Alzheimer's disease. But it's a frame shift again in the way we've been thinking is to who do we put into these kinds of clinical trials, because it's a risk for people. If they're not showing signs of clinical decline, should we be giving them drugs already?
Yeah.
So it's something that really does need to be tested, but I think this is how science has sort of moved at trying to find those right populations and make sure that the drugs are safe as well as effective in those populations.
And I could see how our results from U.S. Pointer 2 to 5 years down the road, because that's the sort of, I love that you showed the life of a clinical trial. Mm. That's one of the things that I think is so important and why that need for increased research and why the quick increase that we've had is so vitally important, because they'll get more stuff in the pipeline, but could have those, some of those implications on being able to have a standard of care for brain health. Mm-hmm. I mean, wouldn't that be a great world that we could live in? And actually, we did get a question, and we're trying to sort through the questions here quickly, but we got a question, and I think this is related to US Pointer, someone about, do trial participants need to be physically healthy? And so maybe we could answer that in regards to Pointer as well as for other clinical trials as well.
Sorry, repeat the question?
Whether or not people need to be physically healthy.
That's a great question. I think what happens is when you approach a clinical trial site to see if you would be a good candidate for a clinical trial, each clinical trial study design will have specific parameters that make candidates a good fit. And it is really based on them trying to be as open as they possibly can to enroll as many participants, but they're also trying to control for variability. So, because again, there's a lot of variability in Alzheimer's disease research, and we need to try to hopefully get results that are going to be significant to move that research forward. So what you will see is both inclusion and exclusion mm-hmm. criteria for different clinical trials. So for some clinical trials, healthy volunteers, or healthy-ish, we all have some problems. Mm-hmm. Healthy volunteers, it would be defined as someone who does not have signs of dementia. They may not also allow you into a clinical trial if you have a pacemaker or something of this nature, because they would need to be able to do the brain imaging or an MRI scan, which means if you have metal in your body, so there, you cannot be a participant. So there may be things that restrict you from being in a clinical trial, but there may be certain conditions that you have that will not restrict you. So we believe that it's really important, if you are interested in research, that you contact the clinical trial investigators, and they will be the ones to tell you what those restrictions are.
Well, yeah, and that's what I love about Trial Match. It allows you to put some of that information into your profile when you create a profile and Trial Match, and so it will hopefully connect you to trials that, if you are on a high blood pressure medication, you're an instant exclusion, you won't be connected to that trial. And so that's why TrialMatch is such a great tool to get people involved in. And I should mention about US Pointer, specifically, we're actually looking for, we sort of describe it as couch potatoes, right? If people are living a healthy lifestyle, we're not going to be able to effectively see that. So you want someone whose diet hasn't been as great and who isn't exercising regularly, and who has the motivation mm-hmm. to be able to want to make those sort of lifestyle changes. Yep. So it really does run the gamut, as you mentioned. Yep. One question that came that I thought was a really good one to talk about, we've been talking a lot about diversity in recruitment of clinical trials, and we've spoken specifically today about Caucasians and African Americans. Are there any studies focusing on either Asian or Asian American groups for risk factors that you're aware of?
I believe there are, but we were even just talking about a grant that is being put in place here in California.
Yeah,
do you want
so
to
there's
mention that?
Sure. So there's an NIH grant proposal that's out right now that's actually getting recruitment focused specifically on diversity, on making sure that we're getting more diversity participants in our clinical trials. And I know of two that are being applied for just here in California. One is focusing on African Americans, but another application is being made around increasing the number of Asians that are being included in mm-hmm. clinical trials, for just the reason that mm-hmm. was mentioned here.
Right, and then if you recall on the worldwide fingers slide, when it comes to lifestyle intervention, there are a number of clinical trials going on in Asian populations. There was the China MIND study. Mm-hmm. There's actually a study that's in development in India right now that's going to be doing a very similar lifestyle intervention trial, as well as South Korea. So we're continuing to work with scientists in Asian countries as well, and it's not just necessarily happening in the US, but I think what you'll find is when you look across a number of different clinical trials that are happening today, many of the people that participate in clinical trials specifically related to Alzheimer's disease and dementia are women, and they happen to be Caucasian women. So it's one of the things that we're trying to increase overall in terms of the diversity of all clinical trials in this particular disease field is African Americans, as well as Hispanics and Asians.
Mm-hmm. So let's switch gears here a little bit from some of the lifestyle intervention trials, because you and I could talk about U.S. Pointer all day, every day. But are there late onset mental health conditions that may be precursors to dementia, like, for example, depression, anxiety disorder, psychosis?
It is a good question. So one of the 10 ways to love your brain, we have some evidence that would suggest that making sure that you're keeping other mental health disease being very eloquent right now, but making sure that you're talking to your doctor about other things related to mental health is very important, because it can potentially exacerbate some of the symptoms that people are experiencing with dementia. We have seen, again, drugs that are in development to tackle depression in a dementia population, or drugs that are in development to tackle agitation or anxiety in a dementia population. But we also do believe that even earlier, before the stages of dementia set in, some of these other changes that are occurring in the brain that are associated with mental health, whether it be depression, anxiety, psychosis, as you pointed out, controlling them as best they can would be best, most helpful and beneficial at at an earlier age, yeah. Before the onset of dementia, yes.
And a couple of questions that we've sorted through here are really asking for a little bit of clarification. I think it's just repeating to make sure that people fully understand those statistics about the risk with the Diane Trials Unit. What was that, when you talked about the one parent versus two parents, if you could just reiterate that.
Right. So. And I didn't go into this, I think, in detail. So when we talk about Alzheimer's disease, the most common version is the late onset, which is after 65. And individuals that have late onset Alzheimer's disease do not have any known genetic mutations, per se, related to Alzheimer's disease. They do have, there are some genetic risk factors, though. And some of the genes that have been mostly studied are looking at a gene called APOE. And there's three different flavors of APOE. There's APOE2, APOE3, and APOE4. And when we talk about APOE, more copies of APOE4, it seems to be that you have a higher risk of developing Alzheimer's disease. But that doesn't mean it's a guarantee. Now, that's different than people that have the dominantly inherited version of Alzheimer's disease, or familial Alzheimer's. They have actually genetic mutations that are taking place on three different genes. There's the APP gene and the presenilin-1 and presenilin-2 genes. Now, their mutations, or what they call misspellings of these genes, can occur in multiple different parts of those genes. And people that inherit those genetic mutations from a family member, from a parent, when we talk, I don't know if you remember the Punnett squares when you were a kid in school, you would get an uppercase and a lowercase letter, the X's and the Y's,
yeah.
and if you get sort of one uppercase letter in that box, that means you essentially would develop the disease. Mm-hmm. So if your parent has one of those mutations, that means you have a 50% chance of getting that mutation. If both of your parents have a mutation, it's almost additive. It's a near 100% confluence that you would get Alzheimer's disease. But again, related to the dominantly inherited version.
And is that the same version that's being studied in Colombia with the families
Yes.
in Colombia?
So there's probably only 200 to 300 families in the world that have what we would call dominantly inherited Alzheimer's disease. And many of them, these families are known to us, and they participate in the dominantly inherited Alzheimer's network in many of these Diane trials. So it is very rare. So out of the 5.8 million Americans alone, only 1% of that population are families that are living with that dominantly inherited version.
Yeah, I had the honor, I would call it an honor, last year, and I know a couple of people in this room have had the same honor over the years to attend. There's always a pre-conference with the Diane two participants
yep.
At the Alzheimer's Association International Conference,
yep.
and They get together every year. There's a family that supports them all coming together for this conference. They get to hear the latest, and then we actually do support groups with them in the afternoon, because people are sort of either waiting to show symptoms. They won't get symptoms, and they're feeling the guilt that kind of goes along with that. It's it really been a fascinating study to really follow over the over time.
Right, and some of the research that I showed today that was in the news related to exercise was actually conducted in a family. There's a large family in Colombia that's being studied, and it was conducted in that family where they were looking at exercise. Yeah. So these people are very, very dedicated to volunteering their time and energy to this research.
And this is a really great question. So somebody asked the question about if they're enrolled in a clinical study, are results indicating dementia or Alzheimer's automatically reported to the DMV in California? So I think this leads us to talk about confidentiality around studies and what it means to truly participate in a clinical trial.
Exactly. So results from the clinical trials are not reported to anyone outside of, they may not even be reported to you, which is another thing to discuss. But that information is sacred, and it's defined by a number of HIPAA laws that would not allow your information to be transferred to other institutions. But when a doctor also may make a diagnosis, that information is not necessarily transferred to any other institution. It really is your private information to share. I think the one thing that I should point out, though, is many, many times we're understanding that doctors are not actually disclosing information about diagnosis to their patients. And that's an entirely different story. And it's one of the things, though, that we do believe is very, very important, because having that conversation with your doctor, if they prescribe you something like Aricept and sort of send you on your way and say, just take this, it'll make you feel better, and don't actually tell you you have the signs of cognitive impairment or dementia or potentially Alzheimer's disease or another related disease, then that needs to be a bigger conversation with the doctor, because disclosure to the patient is very, very important. And we believe that there's a number of important benefits related to that kind of disclosure. You certainly are going to be able to have a deeper conversation about defining exactly what disease you might have and whether or not there's tools available to treat it. But you also have the potential to get involved in clinical trials and at an earlier stage. So not telling somebody their diagnosis, as I heard Claire used a great example, is basically like not telling someone what their blood pressure is. I mean, it's essential to creating a care plan and for the patient and doctor to be working together during that conversation.
Well, and that's why the IDEAS trial is so exciting.
Yes.
Somebody had asked the question about PET scans, and that's, they're not available right now for people to just be used as a diagnostic tool, but the IDEAS trial and new IDEAS could actually change that trajectory, which is really exciting, and make it a clinical tool that's used by physicians.
Yes.
So that's exciting. I'm going to make you test your short-term memory.
Okay.
Or maybe your long-term memory.
Someone
asked you to define again late but slowly, so that they can...
Late.
And that's the one yesterday you had a little trouble remembering all
it's
four parts.
Late is defined as limbic predominant age-related TDP-43... encephalopathy.
There we go. She did pretty good, didn't she? One question around the Sprint Mind study came up. We talk a lot in the results about that, about the systolic level.
Mm-hmm.
Were they looking at diastolic as well?
I think they were not necessarily focused on diastolic as much, but I do believe those numbers were reported in the paper, but I don't have them off the top of my head.
The diastolic and the systolic have two sort of different functions too, right? They kind of they report out sort of two different measures completely that one wouldn't necessarily be...
Correct. Yeah. And I think, however, that being said, typically the diastolic number usually raises when is usually high if the systolic number is high. In this study, it is very important to point out that people that were enrolled in the Sprint Mind trial all had high blood pressure above at least 140, and most of them were averaging about 150. So very high blood pressure at the time, and it was. We've had a lot of questions about blood pressure as you age tends to go up, but we also are concerned about blood pressure being too low in individuals as well. So this is a study population that had a very tightly controlled blood pressure over time. Their blood pressure was being tested frequently, and medications were being titrated frequently to make sure that their blood pressure was not too high or too low, and that any other lifestyle intervention that they were taking to manage that blood pressure was being incorporated into sort of the treatment regimen.
This is a good question, and I think you alluded to it a little bit of it earlier, but there's a higher proportion of women diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. What's our current thinking on that?
Great question, and it's the stumper, I think, mm-hmm. of the century, because right now we used to think that women...
I was going to say, we thought we knew.
We used to think that it was because women lived longer than men, that they had a higher life expectancy than men. But at this point, when you control for things like life expectancy, most research is pointing to the fact that there's probably other biological causes for their increased prevalence. We do not know yet exactly what that biological cause is. We featured a number of different researchers at AAIC last summer that were looking at some of the reproductive health across a lifespan, and I'm using that word kind of generally to encapsulate a number of different studies. It sort of encompassed looking at hormones, it looked at pregnancies, it looked at menopause, it looked at menstruation, it looked at maybe trying to better understand, again, is it these changes that women can experience that men would not experience? Are these part of the factors?
Yeah.
But in terms of the hypothesis behind exactly what biological change it is, we still don't know. Because even when we look at reproductive health, there's a number of things that can change. Or for women who go through pregnancy, their immune systems change very significantly. Their vasculature changes. Their social system changes when they have children. And so these are the kinds of things that are actually being studied right now to more definitively define exactly what it might be, but we just don't know yet.
Yeah, and some of those initial results that came out last year were done right here in Northern California.
Yes, yeah, well, there was a very large study at Kaiser Permanente that looked at over 14,000 women related to pregnancy.
When we talked about U.S. Pointer, and you and I have had the opportunity and privilege to get to sit on some of those worldwide finger calls that happen at various times of the day and night, as you can imagine. How are we designating what countries are coming on next with worldwide fingers?
Oh, you know, the association itself is not designating that. I think what we're trying to do is encourage any researchers who are interested to get involved in the Worldwide Fingers Consortium. The discussions, though, that are taking place are really between the researchers and some of the steering committee of Worldwide Fingers Consortium is trying to make sure that those kinds of, the way that they're building the studies are going to align with other studies that have been done in the past so that we can create a bank of data that would be that would be comparable across a number of different countries. Like I said, a diet in China or a diet in India is not going to be exactly the same recommendation that we would make in the United States for people living there. And so we need to really be able to still harmonize that information. Mm-hmm. I can tell you, it was just announced, I think about a month ago, we had our Alzheimer's Association International Conference Satellite Symposium that was happening in Sao Paulo, Brazil, and they announced a Latin American Fingers that's really going to be a collaboration between a number of countries in Latin America that will be looking across those lifestyle interventions.
Yeah, and I think it's so important. I remember last year at that first consortium meeting before AAIC, we were hearing from the people from India who were trying to explain older women in India are not going to exercise. Like it's just culturally not something that they will do. So how can we still see how those interventions can be successful and yet also be mindful and respectful of those cultural differences between people within the world. One question, going back to Pointer, we talked about the diversity, talking about specifically African Americans and Latinos for this particular trial, that we want at least 23% of people participating to be Latino or African American. Has there been research or work done within this, not specifically to Pointer, but other trials around also looking at socioeconomic issues? That's come up in a couple of our questions.
Yes. So what we know now, and these numbers will probably change as we continue to learn, but what we know now is, first of all, we do not have enough diversity within the research data sets to really make firm conclusions about how these diseases affect different races and ethnicities. So we're really encouraging this kind of proactive approach across the entire field to increase diversity in studies so that we have better information. But what we do know now is that African Americans are 2 times more likely to get Alzheimer's disease than Caucasians. Hispanics, Latinos are 1.5 times more likely than Caucasians. And what we need to continue to learn, though, is why.
Yeah.
We don't yet know if it's related to genetics. We don't yet know if it is related to socioeconomic determinants, disparities. We also know that in many of the African American and Hispanic Latino populations, we have a higher comorbidities of other health concerns that are also risk factors for Alzheimer's disease. Poorer cardiovascular health, poorer education, and even within our own United States. And this is something that needs to absolutely change. So these are the kinds of things that really need to be studied more, and they're absolutely under investigation, and we're continuing to learn more each day, but we don't yet know yet exactly what it is.
And unfortunately, we are out of time for our Q&A, which always happens, and we have a number of cards still here on the desk, but what we typically try to do is gather some information about these and have the opportunity to communicate that to you either through some of our social media channels or even through an email. We'll try and get these questions answered for you. A lot of really great questions. I want to take a moment to thank you, Dr. Edelmeyer,
sure.
for sharing so much of your day with us.